Today's iPain webinar will cover mind-bending heart rate variability, and our special guest is Dr. Ron Gharbo.
This is a patient of mine. She has multiple medical problems. She's probably never going to be totally free of pain because of the physical component, but she was open-minded and ready and stuck. You know, we judge people only as stuck, not stuck, ready, or not ready. And she was stuck and ready. Part of her component of depression and pain was social isolation. So you can see here this door that she painted. You can see the doorknob there. On the other side of the river is Yorktown, Virginia, where most of her friends live. This is her goal, is to be able to get across the river more frequently, and that's what we work towards. I think it's important when you do have financial physical ailments that have to be addressed, that there is no escape button, that I do feel strongly that this is the way through with patients in a mindful partnership. I've already talked that there's little dispute that HRV is a strong predictor of physical health. It's a strong predictor of emotional resistance, resilience in large studies. This year, the nice meta-analysis that came out that shows that HRV, reduced HRV, is associated with chronic pain. We also know that the healthy arrhythmia, that it is a restorative state. We also know that exercise and HRV biofeedback can augment HRV. HRV technology is also rapidly overcome some of our barriers. One of the barriers is right now we have to do a chest lead, which makes it cumbersome. At some point, we're going to have an easy-to-use chest lead, a sticker, or put on a T-shirt or something, and it will communicate maybe with a watch or a Fitbit or iPhone or something that will connect to a cloud. A lot of potential in the future. I had one of my patients who's an artist do this diagram for me, and here's the big lesson. So in technology, you can rewrite programs all you want. So the programs are pretty much written when you're in this erratic HRV rhythm. It's a stimulant. It is the sympathetic state. When you get in that, what I showed you, the harmonious rhythm, they can write programs that make it green. And so what's different is that now when you make this shift, when you're doing biofeedback, that the brain will pick it up. The green arrow represents the vagus nerve, which carries the relaxation response signal from the heart to the brain. The brain picks it up. So it can change the equation when there's conflict going on in the brain, whether it's emotional and physical or both, that you can actually now, using the diaphragm, manipulate the heart to create a different balance in the brain of tone between relaxation and fight or flight. So I want you to think of bottom up versus top down. And I threw a few things the way I kind of categorize them. It's not that top down is wrong. I just feel like we've spent a lot of attention on habit formation and quote unquote trying to work hard to think right under stress. But maybe it's also time to learn some awareness skills, listening skills, perceptive skills, and I put some of those on the left-hand side. For me, initially, it was mindfulness-based stress reduction out of the University of Massachusetts. It's been around for 30 years, a secular meditation program. When I found out about HRV, I was trying to figure out what was going on with me, within me and within my practice, that HRV helped answer some of those questions. So next month, in an article coming out, trying to explain one of the big misconceptions, or to help try and clarify what's going on. When you're taught to drive, we put our right foot on the gas, and to keep things simple, so we don't mess up, we use our right foot and move to the brake. Formula One drivers are high-performance drivers, and they want to be able to react quicker, not lose as much power as they're going, speeding into a curve, maintain some control. But our bodies are high-performance vehicles. So left foot braking with the autonomic nervous system is when you got your foot on the gas pedal, you're living your life with your foot on the gas pedal, you do this breathing technique and you initiate the relaxation response, or in this situation, the braking, you're engaging your left foot. So when you engage the left foot with this breathing technique, you now have your foot on the gas and the brake. That's why breathing techniques aren't enough. You're going to have to, at some point, let up off of the gas. So decisions will have to be made in your life or in the situation to help resolve that. There's a heart rate monitor on a police officer, and you can see this is beat-to-beat changes, and his average heart rate is in the upper 70s to 80s. He gets a phone call to go to domestic violence. It goes up. He gets there, he's engaged, his heart rate is appropriately in the fight or flight response at 170s, and then appropriately goes down, but he's sort of here in the 110s. My premise is that when you're living in a stressed out life or occupation, you can end up living like this, and this signal to stay like this goes into as we go to bed and go to sleep. And so we don't recover as well. And what do we know about disorders like fibromyalgia? We know that they don't get good quality sleep. So using an HRV technique, you can drop your average heart rate down and live more healthy. If you practice the breathing techniques 10 minutes before going to bed, it's been shown to show more restorative sleep. I want to introduce something called stop, shift, and decide. And the way to think about it is first stop to help stop the racing brain. Develop this habit objectively with a clock and your diaphragm. When you breathe 5 seconds in, 5 seconds out, using a clock, you will develop this harmonious rhythm. The brain will pick up that the heart is now in a more calm state, and maybe now I can think a little clearer. Right now, the diaphragm is the one in control, and the heart is sort of getting in sync with the diaphragm. Where the leap of faith is, and you can lose some of our scientists, is the next step, shifting emotion on demand. And I consider this a coachable skill. And in this situation, if you're exercising, your diaphragm now is moving much quicker. You don't have a choice. But the heart, if you've developed this habit, engage a positive emotion, the heart can get in sync with the lung. It can basically catch the wave, like surfing, this faster moving diaphragm. So it's sort of the opposite. Instead of now the diaphragm is moving quicker, and see if you can, if your heart is used to catching this wave and getting in sync, it can be very effective. And on the left here is the best Swedish biathlete, and they go from powerfully skiing to trying to be calm and be precise with shooting. And this lady has a picture of her baby to help drop her down. On the right is a triathlete that we worked with that was wonderful, swimmer and runner, but the biking was difficult and first learned the habit for her pre-performance anxiety. And then she was able later to, after she developed that, she was able to better do it actually while she was in the biking portion, because previously she'd be out ahead in swimming and people would be passing her in the biking, and then she'd start to go in a negative direction. And obviously in a competition, if you can remain more efficient, if you can be in coherence more, you'll have more energy for later in the race and her performance is improved. This is the actual picture that I put on my smartphone and with a little biofeedback device several years ago. And the best way I can explain it, and you know, for cynics out there, they may not be able to do this, but it's really not about going to your happy place or remembering gratitude. It's really about feeling gratitude. This is me with my two daughters when they were little. We were in Puerto Rico, and really get into the details. 2 days before, the little one on the left, she fell. She went unconscious in my hand. Her eyes rolled up in the back of her head. It was unconscious in my hand for a minute or two. The one on the right, normally always wiggling, but for this picture, she managed to settle in for a picture. It was a nice, calm day. Behind my wife taking the picture was a family cooking Puerto Rican rotisserie chicken, which is a wonderful smell. So as I'm under stress and so forth and trying to break free, you try it and feel deep appreciation as opposed to just remembering it. And it's a skill. And it comes a little easier after you've developed that other habit. Usually prescribe 10 minutes twice a day and then as needed. Here's a 24-hour monitor. What you're looking for is, and you can write the programs any way you like, and at night, this is what you want. You want to be in the green in this signal to the brain that you're in recovery. So for athletes, you tear down your muscles when you weightlift during the day. For students, you study and you go to classes. And at night is when you build your bones, build your muscle, and build your brain. And that's the growth period. So I had one question about growth hormones. So when you're trying to use functional medicine doctors and they're using growth hormones, you know, you can stimulate the growth response, the healing response, and I like to, so I can get co-opt athletes, I'll use the term anabolic sleep. And that's a trigger for the recovery state. But you also want to sprinkle in these episodes of green. This lady was one of our first cases, and what I want to point out is she came to me, she had a tunnel collapse on her arm, and she had complex regional pain syndrome. The way I want you to think of that, it is a regional fight or flight software problem. She ended up having three surgeries to the wrist. They ended up moving the nerve at the elbow and ended up taking a rib out for thoracic outlet syndrome. She came to me 13 years after the event, starting to have shoulder pain in the right shoulder, and she was contemplating surgery. She got approved for 8 sessions. After 4 sessions, she thought she was getting something out of this, and we got approved for a second set of 4. And on the 5th session, she figured something out. She began to do a little bit better, not terrific, over the next 2 sessions. But then after that, she started to do real well, and she actually didn't do her 6th, her 7th and 8th session. Over a year later, she decided not to have a surgery. She's doing real well, and I said, let's get on the instrument. You're doing great. Let's see what's going on. And she does this. She knocks it out of the park. I'm like, what's going on? And so up here, you see her average heart rate. A year and a half later, her average heart rate is 10 to 15 points lower. That is a mark of health. So we changed the way she approached a certain relationship, her mother-in-law in her life that she was caring for and so forth, and managing that conflict was additive in the, you know, there's a chronic pain cycle, but I believe there's a healing cycle too, and she turned the corner. Some of those are based on her decisions as well.